part two for those of you joining us for the first time. Our theme is early Adventism and social justice. And it's obvious, there's no need to even explain why that is a relevant, pressing theme at this time. We're looking at how early Adventist pioneers navigated the call to preach the gospel while also addressing social justice issues in their society. How did the early Adventists, or how does studying early Adventist history help us understand how to respond to the issue of racism in America? How to understand the tension between political issues, religious issues, and when there's actually no distinction between those two categories. We began last week by setting the stage. I think most people don't realize that the Seventh-day Adventist denomination was actually born during a time of racial turmoil in this country. We mentioned last week that the name Seventh-day Adventist was chosen in 1960, and this church did not organize as a denomination until 1863, right in the middle of a civil war over slavery in America. So that should already tell us something about the identity, the movement of Adventism as it relates to the social issue of slavery, to the social justice issue of racism, because that's the context that the movement was actually born into. So I think that's very fascinating to me, and I'm still trying to milk all the significance that comes from that. This week, we're gonna transition. We left off getting pretty close to the doorstep of the American Civil War. We began in the 1840s, we talked about the Millerites, the Adventist roots of the Millerites. We talked about the abolition movement. And now we're getting to the late 1850s and into the 1860s. We're brushing up right to the Civil War. And to get us there, I think it's appropriate to begin by wrestling with a tension that Adventists have been wrestling with since day one at the gate. And that is the belief that Jesus is coming back, the imminent second coming of Jesus, on the one hand, and on the other hand, this world is messed up, right? This world is messed up, and how does the Christian who has the urgent conviction that Jesus is coming again, how do you navigate that? How do you negotiate that with the belief that the world around us needs help, that there's the abuse of power, that there's oppressive policies, that there's persecution and all of these things? So how do you navigate that tension? And so I think it's interesting how that the fact that that is not a new dilemma, that is not a new problem that Seventh-day Adventists are just wrestling with in recent decades, but that was actually something they were wrestling with in the 1850s. There is a debate that I want to ask Doug to chime in on. The debate is between a prominent Adventist leader, Uriah Smith, and another Adventist, Anson Byington. And I want to remind our viewers that last week we talked about Anson's brother, John Byington, who actually was the first General Conference president. Not only that, he was a zealous abolitionist. He signed anti-slavery petitions to Congress. He was involved in the Underground Railroad, building churches with secret hiding places for fugitive slaves. His brother Anson gets into a debate with Uriah Smith in the pages of the Review and Herald. And I want us to wrestle with that, all of us. But I want to ask Doug, because I first encountered this in Doug's book, Adventism and the American Republic. So Doug, can you set the stage? What were these two men arguing about in 1856, I believe it was?
Yeah, well, thank you, Jeffrey. I'm excited to talk about this rip-roaring debate that is back to the 1850s. I almost remember it, but not quite. But anyway, I want to try to show a progression from the 1850s and the 1860s, because in the 1850s, most of the early Seventh-day Adventists were not in favor of voting. And that's the opinion that Uriah Smith expresses in the review in his editorial there as we come to an election season. But what theology were they acting out, to use the way Ty framed it? It was not that we mustn't get involved with anything secular or worldly. We need to stay back and just wait for the Lord to come. It had more to do with two things. One was purity, but purity of witness. We want to put ourselves on the side of truth and righteousness. And into the 1850s, prior to this election, both major parties, the Democrats and the Whigs, had pro-slavery and Northern factions.
So this is before the Republican Party, just to be clear.
Yeah. So I'm just giving that as a background for this mindset that comes into 1856 on the part of most of the Seventh-day Adventists. And that is that we shouldn't be voting, because it's any way we do that, we're not going to be witnessing appropriately. There is also, as you pointed out, the urgency of the second coming. Remember, this is only a dozen years after 1844. And so the intensity of the expectation, they're not looking for long years to unfold. They really seriously believe that it's going to be very, very soon. So Uriah Smith says, we know now the Republican Party, this is the first time in which they are on the national ticket. And they're a little bit better because they take a stand against the spread of slavery. But that, for the radical William Lloyd Garrison and also for Uriah Smith and many Adventists, that wasn't good enough, because they're still allowing slavery to exist within its present borders. And so Smith says, well, we know which side every Christian should be on. I mean, if it's a question of slavery versus abolition, temperance versus intemperance, so forth, and he listed a few others. But in this setting, we don't think that it's appropriate or even useful to get embroiled into the campaign. And we're looking for Jesus to come and take over this thing very, very soon. And the best thing we can do for people is to help get them ready. So that comes back to the way that you set it up very well. Well, what about Anson Byington? Well, as you said, Anson was an abolitionist. I mean, he's a certified card-carrying Underground Railroad person. It was at the last stage in Williston, Vermont. And there is a historian named Brother Joseph Poland who chronicled some of this after the war. And he said dozens and hundreds came through on the last stop to Canada, and Anson helped with that. It's not entirely clear whether Anson actually joined a Seventh-day Adventist church, but he started taking the review in 1853 or 1854. Well, we come now to this debate that you referred to, and he writes in reacting to Smith and the idea that we cannot really do anything that's worthwhile against slavery in view of the Lord's soon return. And he says, you know, when I started subscribing back in 53, I thought you were on the side of anti-slavery. But he didn't like the tone that Smith had set later. And so Brother Smith, he says, I'm going to have to discontinue. After my subscription runs out, I'm not going to be able to renew. And he says, I dare not tell the slave that he can afford to be contented in his bondage until the Savior comes, however near we may believe his coming. And then he goes on to say, surely the editor of the review could not afford to go without his breakfast till then. If it was our duty to remember those in bounds as bound with them 1800 years ago, it must still be our duty He alludes to Matthew 25, and then he says, but, you know, if we don't do anything, our response to the Lord will be, alas, we saw the slave in prison, but on reading the prophecy that there will be bondsmen as well as freemen at Christ's coming, we have excused ourselves from any efforts for his emancipation. And then he goes on to say, by the way, I have been trying to keep the seventh-day Sabbath for the past couple of years. So he is kind of part of the community by way of the review, and he's become a Sabbatarian. So I think that is a very interesting challenge to Smith's idea. So Smith comes back and says, well, you have a good point, but really what can we do practically and so forth? And again, he reiterates his views about the nearness of the second coming. And then Byington comes back and he gets into the prophecy of the two-horned beast, Revelation 13. And he says, that makes sense to me. I admit that the legislation, not only of the slave states, but also the nation, is dragon-like enough to warrant the application of the prophecy of the two-horned beast to our government. But I deny that our federal constitution anywhere speaks as a dragon. But on the contrary, I maintain that its prohibitions and provisions are ample to nullify all Sunday laws as well as slave laws and to fulfill secure liberty, the great ends for which it was ordained of God through the people of the United States. So he says, I agree with you, but in view of not only the mandates of scriptures to be identifying with those who are in bonds, to be treating others, the least of these, as if they were the Savior and as we would want to be treated, and in view of however convincing the prophecy may be, it doesn't mean that there is no basis for using that to call for change.
Yeah, and that's
to work for
that.
People.
That's the point there that I think is so fascinating about that debate, right? You have a guy writing into the review saying, "Hey, brother Smith, you're way too soft on slavery. You're too soft.
Yeah,
you're fixated you're fixated on the second coming of Jesus. You're harping on the second coming of Jesus, and that eventually the slave too will be set free if we can hasten the second coming of Jesus. And so there's that debate. Go ahead.
Yeah. So Smith comes back and says, all right, well, no more back and forth on this. But time will tell who will be correct. So Smith is very confident the Lord will come soon. He will be proven correct. But within a very few years, actually, Anson, I think, was proven correct. Because in the next few years, through the Civil War, and by the time we get to the election of 1864, and the General Conference of 1865, there has been a clear shift in Anson Byington's direction on the part of the Adventist pioneers. And we can go further to that if you desire.
That's great. That's
in other
great.
Words, in favor I think, of voting.
Yeah, of voting. And I think, but when we say voting, that's very specific. We can apply voting to a broader principle, to action, right? To intervention. Yeah. So the concept there that Adventism doesn't just fixate on the second coming of Jesus, on the future at the expense of attempting to make changes to society in the present, that there's no contradiction between those two. And I think it's fascinating that you said that in the end, Anson actually won the debate because at least in those decades, the church leaned toward Anson's perspective, saying you could do both. You can emphasize the second coming of Jesus, and in fact, that could actually energize you, right, to make this world a better place.
If I could just briefly sort of show that with J.N. Andrews in the 1864 election. Okay, this is when Lincoln is up for re-election. He has committed himself. The Emancipation Proclamation has gone forth. And now he's committed himself to the constitutional amendment to actually end slavery entirely. But his opponent is a peace Democrat, McClellan. And if McClellan wins, we might end the war on easy terms and slavery comes back. So what Andrews does is he connects it to the judgment. In other words, it's still a close connection between the last things, our view of what the future that Christ is leading us toward. But Andrews says, listen, if you think that you're going to be able to smug a pro-slavery vote past the judgment because you put it in a box called politics, and you think it's then not going to come under of the final judge, he said, you've got a very serious disappointment coming.
Wow.
And so it's very clear that in view of our expectations about Christ's return and coming to judge against evil and oppression, we need to be aligned with that in the present.
Yeah, that's so relevant. I love that.
Something, Kevin. Something, I just want to make sure something is added here. I don't think you mentioned it, Doug, but just so people know, this debate between Anson and Anson Bynson and Uriah Smith played out on a larger scale between William Lloyd Garrison and all of the people in the Liberty Party, the so-called political abolitionists. And I maybe that's going to be lost on people. But the second coming thing is something Uriah adds to this. But Garrison, I don't think you mentioned, Doug, but and I know you know this, but Garrison himself is advocating that you shouldn't vote. And so the radical abolitionists.
Why?
Yeah, because
why should we not vote according to these radicals?
Yeah, Doug, you go ahead and take it. Either one of us
well,
can do it. But you go ahead.
Garrison, although his view of the millennium was much different, it was more of a spiritual type view, he believed that you need a saving remnant that's going to be a pure witness, and that we have to transform the hearts and minds of the nation first. And voting is not going to do any good until you do that. But he also changed so that by 1864, he said, don't even vote. That's the wrong way to go about transformational change in the nation. We just need to put the power of truth out there.
Yes.
But in 1864, when you have a party that's in place ready to actually end slavery, if they're retained in power, then Garrison, he's out campaigning for Lincoln now.
So, okay. So that's the reason why Adventists eventually do not adopt the don't vote premise, because they can't ignore the fact that God holds us accountable for what we've done on this earth.
They parallel the Garrisonian step by step all the way through 1864 through the end of the Civil War. So
I think that's a great concept that you said about the judgment does not allow us to put into a box and just label it politics. I don't do politics, and therefore just go about our business just looking forward to the second coming of Jesus. Now, okay, I want to transition from this, which is, I think these are good foundational stones, to discussing at the time in the 1850s, there were ideas floating around, not only in the world broadly speaking, but within the Christian establishment, ideas about race, how they theorized about race, how they viewed race. And of course, obviously, this played a big role into why there's even slavery in America to begin with. I want to talk a little bit about what were some of the main ideas floating around about race at the time that justified viewing races as inferior, and how did Adventists stick out from the consensus at the time?
So the main thing on that score comes from the Bible, in the book of Genesis, chapter 9, verses 24 through 27, and then you really need to know chapter 10, verses 6 through 20 as well. And this is a prevalent idea that scholars now refer to as the myth of Ham, sometimes the curse of Canaan. And this is a story about after the flood, you know, Noah plants a vineyard, gets drunk. And then it's his son Ham who laughs at his father's nakedness, all this kind of stuff. And then his father says, "Cursed be Canaan, a servant of servants shall be he shall be to his brethren." And so that's this curse that that people fixate on. And here's what they do. Just in case people aren't aware, like most people assume that race is sort of a biological fact. But when I'm talking about race, scholars have pointed out it's very clear that it's a human construction and it was only invented in recent times. It's only since the early modern period that we've actually used the word race and tried to taxonomize bodies based upon how they look, based on skin color, hair type, whatever. And so it's a very modern invention. But people in the 19th century did not think that way. They thought that race just always existed as a fact. And so they tried to find the source for the so-called three great races, and they looked to the sons of Noah for that. Okay, and so they say, okay, Noah had three sons. They were the ones who populated the earth after the flood. And so that must be where all the races came from. And so they come up with this idea that Noah's three sons were different colors somehow, which I find very strange, because how would Noah have sons with different skin colors? But they believe this. And so it went that Japheth was white, okay? Shem was yellow and Ham was black. And so from those three sons, that's where all of the different races come from. And those are the three great races. And at this time, they thought there were only three. Later in the 20th century, you get dozens of races, et cetera. And it gets even more complex and confusing. And yeah, if you want to know more about the history of race, read something like Nellerin Painter's A History of White People or something, and that will be helpful. But yeah, so this is...
So tell us how that gets racialized against blacks.
This is basically the source for black people. And because they connect Ham with the curse, this is how it gets tied in with race, and how there's this belief that black people are actually cursed. And so they are meant to be subjugated.
Because of their linkage to Ham.
Because it says in the Bible, cursed be Canaan, a servant of servants. And so they read that as slaves. Okay? And so they get things wrong. First of all, Ham is not cursed. Okay? It's his son Canaan that is cursed. And people regularly got that wrong in the 19th century. They literally were misreading the Bible on that score. And so they are making this assertion that it's the black race comes through Ham, and Ham is cursed. It's really Canaan that's cursed, or whatever. And so they link this as a way that it is natural, and it is meant to, it is God's plan for the so-called black race to be subjugated to the white race, for the black race to be subjugated to Shem and Japheth, who they also connect with Christians and Jews. And so this is what's going on. And here's the point to stress. Literally, North and South, almost every single American believes this as if it is fact. You don't question, like, no one questions this except for the abolitionists. The abolitionists,
Kevin,
are the only people questioning this.
Kevin, yes. I just wanted to throw in real quick, and I want you to continue, but I wanted to throw in real quick that I've read, like, debates on the Senate floor.
Yeah.
In Congress, and you have senators, you have congressmen.
Oh, yeah.
Throat peddling this exact idea that black people come from the curse of Ham.
Yep.
And in their debates about slavery, about race, literally in Congress, these are ideas that are influencing American policy. So I just want that to be very clear there.
Thank you for adding that. I mean, this is one of the, perhaps the most important factor when it came to understanding race. And I don't mean black people necessarily. I mean the concept of race, what race is, where it came from, all this kind of stuff. And this drives American slavery and racism and subjugations of blacks for decades and decades and decades to come. And it's still not dead. I've heard it in my lifetime. But Seventh-day Adventists had a different view. They were abolitionists, and they were along with abolitionists who reject this. And so if you read the review, there's articles in the review that are published, and they point out, first of all, it was actually Canaan that was cursed, not Ham. So they set the record straight by accurately reading that text in the Bible.
As you would expect from a bunch of...
Yes, Bible-believing Christians,
right? Bible-thumping Adventists.
Right. But then they also stress out, and they say this. They say the descendants of Canaan were not Africans. They were Canaanites. Okay? Canaanites, not Africans. They were not black. They were Canaanites. Okay? Everyone, no one else is believing this. This is a rare thing. It's shocking. You know, like you read it and it's like Canaanites. Yeah, I get that. But like, no one believed that. They all thought it was that they were Africans and black. And they said, yeah, that's not right. They were Canaanites. Okay. And also that curse, it wasn't a prophecy about race. It was actually just a point in time of a specific event. And they said what that curse was is that that whenever Israel was let out of the of Egypt, you know, with the Exodus, they go up to Canaan and they drive out the Canaanites. Okay, and that's what this curse is prophesying about. So it's a specific event that would elapse for a period of time and then cease. It wasn't supposed to last for eternity. And so that was another major difference. And then it gets even more interesting because they flip it. Along with all the other abolitionists at the time, these are common arguments for abolitionists, but no one else. I mean, they flip it and they say, who actually was cursed? It was actually slaveholding Americans. And they actually argue that, no, who were the real descendants of Canaan? American slaveholders. And they make clever arguments that I'm sure no one would agree with today, but that it's interesting to see that they flip it, because they're wanting to point out what is really the curse of America is slavery, not black people. And that's incredibly radical, unbelievably radical. And so they say, nope, it's slaveholders who are cursed, and they're taking advantage of this curse, co-opting it, reinterpreting it, and trying to make it about subjugating a race of people that God loves as made in the image of God. And so this is what Adventists are saying consistently in their publications before the Civil War ends, okay? And even into the later 1860s, it goes through probably to at least 1867, 1870. And then all of a sudden, the curse of Ham just drops off. No one seems to talk about it in Adventist print. And then it reemerges in 1902 is the earliest that I've been able to find. And all of a sudden, you see a radical shift.
Can we leave this part out of our conversation? Because it's always depressing. It always begins like, man, that's what I'm talking about. That's inspiring. And then it's like, yeah, but then in the 1900s, they lost the plot. It's just depressing.
Lost the plot. I mean, do you not want me to share it?
Just share it, but just don't get into too many details, because I'm just going to get depressed over here.
Okay. The simple point is that by the early 1900s, early 20th century, Seventh-day Adventists had gone along with the majority of Americans, and they are saying, yep, black people are cursed because of the curse of Canaan. And so they are meant to be subjugated. The curse of Canaan prophesied that they would be slaves in America. They say all of this kind of stuff all the way through the 1950s. So for example, in 1954, an Adventist article titled The Bible Origins of Race, published in the Signs of the Time, this is what they say. Quote, Ham means burnished, an intimation of the dark-skinned races which sprang from him. According to this prophecy, the descendants of Ham were to be slaves. The distinguishing feature of Africa, the main home of Ham's descendants, has always been slavery. Boom. But it does get a little better, because some Adventists, at least, and like I said, this is still around. It's still in Adventism. I've heard it many times. However, at least some Adventists began to wake up in the 1960s and 70s during the Civil Rights Movement.
Civil rights, yeah, exactly.
Civil rights movement. And they started to debunk the myth of Ham in Adventist print, and they say, nope, this curse is not about race. And they argue that race didn't exist in Bible times, and so the concept of race isn't in the Bible. And so that kind of thing, it does get righted a little bit, although it's not righted enough because it's still talked about some. But there's a little bit of a positive note to get back to, but nevertheless, we do have something to be ashamed of during those first decades into the 20th century.
And I wanted to say, you know, about the being ashamed part, obviously I was kidding. You know, I think it's pivotal for us. We got to deal with the dirty laundry, because otherwise we're not learning, right? The whole purpose of history is to learn from it. And you learn from the ups and you learn from the downs. And I think that the fact that the Adventist Church just receded from being on the forefront of social justice issues, I think all of these things play into why the blade was softened, so to speak. Now, we're going to get to some more of that era in next episode or the following one in our series. But to go back now to just the Civil War era, what you've talked about there about the myth of Ham and how at least in that period, Adventists were resisting some of the not only political, not only cultural, not only social supports for racism and slavery, but also the theological supports for slavery. And I think that that's a good place there to segue into the fact that just by knowing that Adventists held these, which were at the time radical views, right, that were in complete opposition to the mainstream, it helps us understand why Adventists would run into trouble, right? why Adventists would rub people the wrong way who were in support of the mainstream. Now, I'm thinking specifically of an article that James White wrote into the Civil War. I think we're in 1862. I think it's August. I think it's the Review and Herald. And you are all familiar with this article. It's entitled The Nation. And in this article, James White, in the context of the Civil War, says, and I'm only highlighting this one point specifically, he says that for years, the church had been teaching that the United States is the second beast in Bible prophecy. He also says that the church is so abolitionist, so committed to anti-slavery, that their publications are banned in the South. So can we just talk about that just at least for a few minutes? That phenomenon of Adventism is mainly flourishing in the North, but their literature gets rejected in the South. And I want to stress this here, for anybody who's done evangelism across the country, you run into opposition, as I have, like in different parts of the nation, where people are not friendly to the teachings, the theology of Adventism. But in this article, James White says, our literature is banned in the South, not because the people in the South hate the Seventh-day Sabbath, not because people in the South are rejecting the sanctuary message or any of the other theological tenets of Adventism. He says, it's because of our position on slavery. So I just want to park right there for a second and just milk that for a few minutes, because I think that's a significant thing for James White to say in 1862.
Yeah, so the background to that is going all the way back to 1831 and Nat Turner's Rebellion, okay, in Virginia. And so in that, Jeffrey, that is the largest slave revolt in America's history, by the way. Mm. And after that happened, Nat Turner was literate. He was able to read. And so he leads this bloody revolt in which, I think it's something like 57 white Americans are slaughtered, most of them women and children. And, the South is in an absolute outrage, and they blame this rebellion on William Lloyd Garrison and David Walker, two abolitionists who had written very radical tracts that had gone down South, and they were convinced that Nat Turner had read these, and those are what led to this revolt. There's no proof of that, that actually happened. It could have happened, but historians just say, we have no idea, there's no way to know. And it doesn't really matter. Nat Turner didn't need that information. He knew how horrible slavery was even without it. And there had been other slave revolts before Garrison or David Walker wrote those things. But the point is that in response, they pass all these draconian laws throughout the southern states. They forbid slaves to learn how to read, for example, which means they can no longer learn the gospel, et cetera, read the Bible, et cetera. And so they're not allowed to read. They also pass laws in the wake of Nat Turner's rebellion that forbid abolitionist print, like Garrison's tract, Liberator and David Walker's tract, they forbid that to be sent via the post office to the South, okay? And so it literally becomes illegal to do this. And as you're marching closer and closer to the Civil War, Southern postmasters and even the Postmaster General, Amos Kendall of the United States, they become to crack down more and more and more, harsher and harsher and harsher. And so by the time you get to the late 1850s, yeah, they start to classify Seventh-day Adventist literature with abolitionist literature because of what they're saying against slavery, you know, with the two-horned beast and other arguments, et cetera. And so they do forbid it. They do outlaw Seventh-day Adventist material because it's going to hurt their peculiar system that they love and cherish. But it's not just their literature. So in 1860, before the Civil War even breaks out, a Seventh-day Adventist minister named Moses Hull, he goes down to Missouri, a border state, okay? And he's preaching sermons there. And they actually allow him to preach. However, they forbid him to sell any Seventh-day Adventist literature that condemns slavery, which was most of it. and they also say, if you speak against slavery, we are going to fine you $50. And just to put that in context, that's roughly about $1,500 in today's money. So they're going to fine him the equivalent of roughly $1,500 and give him 6 months in jail. Mm. And so Moses Hull was among other Adventists, not just, so our ministers and our literature are forbidden in the South.
Okay. Kevin, I love that. I love that for a number of reasons. One of the reasons I love that is because the thought, I was just struck by the thought, it's interesting that Adventist theology should be so in tune with the concept of human dignity, with the concept of social justice, that you should not be able to present any tenet of the doctrinal system within Adventism without making people feel uncomfortable who undermine human dignity. And I love that. So I love the idea of Adventist literature being banned in the South, and just, at least in my imagination, Adventist preachers being deemed dangerous in the South, because when they start preaching, people start realizing that human beings matter regardless of the color of their skin. And because they matter so much, accepting Adventist theology would make you rebel against slavery. Man, what? that sounds like the way it should be preached. That sounds like the way Adventist event, that sounds like the effect that Adventist evangelism should be having in communities where it is introduced. Not just proof texting, trying to convince people of what day to go to church in, but where you so seamlessly connected to the beauty of humanity and how much God cares about humanity, that anybody that's messing with that should start feeling nervous. Okay, we need to move on there because we're 41 minutes in, and I'm just loving it. I want to move on a point here, and I'm gonna try to provoke Brother Ben to come out and preach. But I know that Brother Ben and Doug, in addition to Kevin, have thought about the South and Adventism in the South. But staying still in the Civil War, right? Not moving past that just yet. I've been thinking recently about some of the periodicals that I've read in the 60s, 1860s and so forth, about what really was the cause. What was the real cause of the Civil War? Now, let me preface what I'm about to say by setting it in maybe current context, right? If our viewers are awake at all, you've heard news around the country that Confederate statues are being dismantled and brought down in different Confederate monuments around the country. And here in where I am in California, that's been happening. And excuse me, not that. Other statues of connected to racism has been happening. Not a whole lot of Confederate statues in California, but throughout the South, we have Confederate monuments coming down. And I read something really interesting, because the debate going on right now in the news and in the media regarding these Confederate monuments is that there's several different points, but one point is that the Confederate memorials are not celebrating slavery per se. They're celebrating the culture, the legacy, the Confederate culture of the South, the heroic defense of the Southern way of life against the forces of the North.
Lost cause.
The lost cause, the celebration of Southern heritage and culture, and attached to that is this notion that the Civil War was not, in essence, over slavery per se. It was over state rights against the encroachments of the North. It was over protecting the legacy of the South and the culture of the South. So with that in mind, I've been reading some passages that I think have really opened my eyes from people even like Uriah Smith, who I often consider one of the more, you know, careful conservatives in some contexts. But I was reading this piece by Uriah Smith, and for our viewers, if you're interested, this is Review and Herald, November 12, 1861. And Uriah Smith, right in the middle of, right at the Civil War, he's frustrated at the U.S. government because he says that the government's, and I'm quoting, imbecility is aggravating, he says. Why? Yeah. Because the U.S. government, and I'm speaking now, because the North, says Uriah, is slow in recognizing that, quote, slavery is the cause of the present war, right? So add to that, this whole concept that the debate's going on right now is that the Confederacy was more celebration of Southern heritage. When you read Adventist literature during the Civil War and shortly thereafter, it's pretty clear that the collective consciousness of Adventism was that this was not about states' rights, per se. Of course, it's about states' rights in order to preserve the institution of slavery, right? So I was talking about this and reading about this and thinking about this, and I think it's pretty relevant to realize that when we read the early pioneers, they had a pretty clear sense, a Frederick Douglass kind of sense, of what the Civil War was all about. Another statement, I think Doug shared this with me, from Ellen White. Ellen White even chimes in on this, and she says, "The North have had no just idea." I'm quoting now from Testimonies, Volume 1, page 253. "The North have had no just idea of the strength of the accursed system of slavery." And listen to this. "It is this, and this alone, which lies at the foundation of the war." So according to Adventist pioneers, the cause of the war was pretty clear. And that made me wonder, of course, I'm no prophet. Of course, we can't. I always wish we could just pull some of these pioneers out from the 1860s and drop them into, you know, Georgia, Louisiana, Texas in 2020. And of course, we can't do that. But it makes me wonder how reading Adventist history should inform our own, the way we evaluate the news and the debates that are going on today. And it makes me wonder, what would Ellen White say about statues that are commemorating the Confederate? In fact, wait a second, Ben, I thought I heard you say something about Ellen White speaking about the satanic forces behind the Confederacy. Am I making that up? Was that a dream I had? Because I do have dreams about you. But was that a dream?
Whoa.
That's creepy. No, I'm just kidding.
Oh. Ellen White says, quote, "Satan was the first great leader in rebellion. God is punishing the North that they have so long suffered the accursed sin of slavery to exist. For in the sight of heaven, it is a sin of the darkest dye. God is not with the South, and he will punish them dreadfully in the end. Satan is the instigator of all rebellion. I saw that you, Brother A, have permitted your political principles to destroy your judgment and your love for the truth. They are eating out true godliness from your heart. You have never looked upon slavery in the right light, and your views of this matter have thrown you on the side of the rebellion, which was stirred up by Satan and his hope. Your views of slavery cannot harmonize with the sacred, important truths for this time. You must yield your views or the truth. You must yield your views or the truth. Both cannot be cherished in the same heart, for they are at war with each other." That's Testimonies, Volume 1. And you can read the entire passage from pages 355 to 368. She says in another place.
That's huge. That's huge.
Yes, it is. She says in another place, "The great leading rebel general, Satan, is acquainted with the transactions of this war. And he directs his angels to assume the form of dead generals, to imitate their manners, and exhibit their peculiar traits of character. And leaders in the army really believe that the spirits of their friends and of dead warriors, the fathers of the Revolutionary War, are guiding them. If they were not under the strongest fascinating deception, they would begin to think that the warriors in heaven did not manifest good and successful generalship or had forgotten their famed earthly skill."
Well then, you know,
okay, it's our history. It's our history.
Yeah. So it's almost like history is important or something.
Yeah.
It's almost like history, like Adventist history matters or something. You know, we were actually talking about this, and Kevin, you had mentioned the the what was it? The Unity, the United Daughters of the Confederacy.
Oh yeah.
United Daughters of the Confederacy, which was the organization that was probably the most influential organization in erecting these Confederate statues and monuments throughout the country. And it's interesting because I found this statement, and I know we always dog on the 1930s. Oh, that's when we lost the plot, right? But I found this thing in 1932. So I'm reading Signs of the Times, March 29, 1932. And at the time, the Georgia legislature was trying to institute a holiday to commemorate Lincoln's birthday, and the United Daughters of the Confederacy, they lobbied in to oppose Georgia instituting Lincoln's birthday, commemorating Lincoln's birthday. And the reason was, I quote, that would dishonor the memory of the dead in our state. In other words, that would dishonor the Confederate soldiers who died to preserve slavery. And then this is what the Adventists say. But what will such a hatred and prejudice do for the younger generation? It goes on and on. I don't want to read the whole thing here, but in essence, what would these decisions that are aimed at retelling the history of slavery in the Civil War, what impact will that have on future generations of young people and their understanding about what happened in this nation, and writing as Adventists, the Adventist perspective on these things? Anyhow, I wanted to stop there for a second to share that, because I think it's very, very interesting that if you went to college, if you went to university and studied 19th century American politics in the Civil War, this concept of the lost cause in the South, it's a major concept to understanding the Civil War and the aftermath of the Civil War. And yet, as I've said in last week, Adventists are behind the scenes debating these very things that are in our secular textbooks. But obviously, the story of Adventism doesn't make it into the textbooks. It's important for us to bring it out here. Okay, so we're in the Civil War. We heard what Adventists are saying. And now Adventists are faced with the conversation of how do you deal with this politically? You know, how do you posture yourself as an Adventist? Do you vote? Do you not vote? Is political engagement legitimate as a Seventh-day Adventist? And we get to two episodes here that I want to just briefly park here for a second. I want to ask Doug to maybe chime in. We have Jane Andrews, who writes an editorial in 1864, and then we have the General Conference, who arrives at a resolution in 1865 regarding these issues on voting and engagement. And can we, in a few minutes, just summarize the significance of those two things and their bearing on our conversation?
Yeah. Now, if I could just maybe briefly suggest that I think we've seen maybe at least three different ways between our conversation last week and this week about how Adventists engaged this most central issue in the public order. And one was that you disobey unjust laws. We talked about that last week. And then secondly, as Ben was quoting, if you're gonna be an Adventist, there are certain political views, namely pro-slavery, they're just simply incompatible with that. It's like by evangelizing, as you were saying, Jeffrey, for Adventism, you're building up a form of abolition society. But then the third thing is taking action through the political process. The editorial is the one I referred to earlier, where he clearly he's indirect, but he's the editor of the review at that point, and he's basically endorsing Lincoln's reelection. But I think it is worth looking at this resolution that was then agreed upon at the General Conference session of 1865. And they here affirm that all right, We got it here. Hold on just a moment. That voting, in our judgment, the act of voting, when exercised in behalf of justice, humanity, and right, is in itself blameless and may at times be highly proper. But the casting of any vote that shall strengthen the cause of such crimes as intemperance, insurrection, and slavery, we regard as highly criminal in the sight of heaven. But we would deprecate participation in the spirit of party strife. I think the key point that I derive from this is that you're using the capacity to vote, the agency that you have as a voter, is connected in a holistic way with your Christian life, your Christian experience. It comes under the moral scrutiny that you want to bring on your actions as you try to reflect Christ's character. It's not always quite so easy, is it? That resolution, exactly how do you decide what is for justice, humanity, and right, and what might go the other way. But you need to be thinking about that. And it's not something that we're somehow absolved of because we're looking for the Lord to return. It's connected with our holistic approach and witness to the world.
Yeah, I love that. I love how you said it in a different conversation we had. You said it, you mentioned that the resolutions that we see the church taking there in the 1865 on voting, it suggests that our actions regarding social injustice matter this side of the second coming, you said. These things matter right, this side right. of the yeah, second yeah. coming. And you even added that our witness is hurt. And we lose something valuable of our Adventist heritage if we take a passive, fatalistic view that says, well, it will only get worse anyways type of attitude. So I think it's interesting that at the highest level of the church, these considerations are being made and these debates are taking place. Let's move on now to the actual maybe action during the Civil War. Now we have about roughly 30 more minutes. We'll end at around 6:30 Pacific time. Let's talk a little bit about during the Civil War. We know that the church took a stand against warfare. We know that Ellen White endorsed the view against killing. We know that the church petitioned the U.S. government for non-combatant, what would you call it, non-combatant status, and that the U.S. government granted the church non-combatant status. But we also know that despite what the church formally organizationally voted, we also know that there was some rank and file among Adventists that were so disgusted with slavery. And actually, I actually did a reading about the kind of debates that were going on about why Adventists should go out there and just grab a gun and just go for it, you know, against the South, against the slaveholders. And it's because they just had this abhorrence against slavery. So you have that tension. I know Kevin has written about that tension and how, in fact, there were Adventists that actually engaged or even supported the engagement of war. Now we don't really have to jump into that, but related to that is the idea that there's some protests. I want Kevin to talk to us about Joseph Clark and hopefully we can talk about Linn County and the petition at Linn County to immediately abolish slavery. Again, some super, super radical Adventism going on right there. So let's get into that for a few minutes.
Yeah, that's good. So you mentioned how some Adventists participated in spite of official church positions, et cetera. But yeah, Adventists on the home front is what you're talking about now. Adventists on the home front were also fighting against slavery, not with gun and knife and bayonet, but in the case of Joseph Clark, with sugar cane from China.
You say that just to be provocative.
I not sure
with
do.
Guns, they fought with sugar cane.
And it's really interesting to think about how Joseph Clark, let me tell you about him. Joseph Clark was probably, he was definitely one of the most influential laymen in Adventist history throughout the 19th century. He wrote hundreds of articles. He was extremely prolific, extremely well-read among Adventists. Everyone knew him. And he also served in leadership positions in his local conference throughout his entire life. So he's an important guy. If you don't know who Joseph Clark is, he's a fun person. And yes, he weaponized his farm during the Civil War. And of course, what does that mean? First of all, you have to understand in the South. The South was really well known for cotton. Everybody knows Cotton Kingdom. Everyone understands cotton. But also, they were really, really into sugar. And so one of the primary place that we got sugar in the North during that time was from the South, and it was grown by slaves. And so whenever the war breaks out, immediately, like within a week or two, probably it had to be within days, really, Joseph Clark orders, imports sugar cane from China. He gets it sent to him in Ohio, and he learns how to grow it, and he plants it. He says he planted it on either May 10 or May 15, 1861. So this is like the war breaks out in early April. So we're talking about like within about 30 days of the war breaking out, he has got Chinese sugar cane in his soil. Why does he have it there? Because he wants the North to be able to have an alternative supply of sugar cane, of sugar, so they don't have to support slave labor, slave grown products. And so he does. He plants it there in the ground in Ohio soil, waits, goes through all the whole summer, and then in November he harvests it. And it actually worked. He figured out how to make it work. And so he goes through and he gives instructions in his local Republican paper and says, this is the kind of soil I used. This is how I fertilized it. This is the issues that I had. This is what worked well. This is what didn't work well. And guess what? I'm confident that not just me, but you, any of you, can actually gain about $22. You can profit $22 per acre if you grow Chinese sugar cane in Ohio. And he said, if we get every Ohio farmer to do this, to plant between a quarter of an acre to 1 acre, we are going to do a drastic, make a major role here and keeping the North from importing sugar from slave grown labor. And so that was how Joseph Clark, Seventh-day Adventist farmer, initially reacted to the Civil War and trying to come up with a way to get slavery issues. And so that's really interesting.
There are other ways. There are other ways to attack the kingdom of darkness without grabbing a shotgun.
And we don't typically think about someone using their farm, but he did it. He did it. And another group of Adventists that are fighting slavery in the home front are in Linn County, Iowa. You mentioned their petition. And so petitioning is something that Seventh-day Adventists were doing long before they became Seventh-day Adventists. They were doing it during the Millerite period. And I could talk to you about numerous radical petitions that are not just about ending slavery, but also to end racism in the North. And so after 1860, when we take the name Seventh-day Adventists, what's fascinating is that we have now found a petition that showed the name of our denomination on the petition. And so I led some of my students from Southern up to the National Archives. And one of our students, I'm going to name him, Xavier Schneider. He was with me. We were sitting there together with a bunch of other students. And he finds his petition written, and it says, quote, "The undersigned Seventh-day Adventists and others, citizens of Linn County in the state of Ohio." And I'm like, I have never seen that on a petition, because all the ones I've looked at so far are from the 1840s. That's why. And so I was like, you're kidding me. We found one with the name of our denomination in the petition. Now, this is rare, folks. There are I've looked through hundreds and hundreds. I've actually looked through thousands of petitions at the National Archives now. And you only rarely find a petition made in the name of a religious body. Usually it's Quakers, but that doesn't happen even that often itself. I have seen like maybe one Baptist petition against slavery. And then I've seen probably a dozen from Quakers out of thousands. And so to find that Seventh-day Adventists, in the name of Seventh-day Adventists, wrote a petition is amazing in and of itself. And so this is what they say in the petition. There are 44 signatures on it. Almost all of them are Seventh-day Adventists from Linn County, Iowa. And they say this. This is a quote from the petition, which was circulated and signed in April 1862, which is before the Emancipation Proclamation was put out in any form. Okay? And so they say this, that no, and they underline no, that no question of the right can be now entertained under the existing circumstances of our national government to proclaim liberty to all the inhabitants of the land. That our professions of Christianity and boasts of liberty are but a mockery in the sight of the nations of the earth and of the God of the universe, so long as we delay practically to recognize the, quote, inalienable right of all men to life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. We therefore urge you, this is addressed to Abraham Lincoln and to Congress, by the way, we therefore urge you as the executive and representative personifications of our national government, by all the considerations of self-preservation and of the allegiance of justice and to God, to abolish by proclamation and without delay the great unnatural crime of slavery, the exhaustless, inveterate source of our national ruin. That's a petition from Seventh-day Adventists in the name of Seventh-day Adventist denomination to Abraham Lincoln and Congress in 1862. And I'm sure there's probably more of those. We just have to find them. They are needles in a haystack, folks. Needles.
That's awesome. I mean,
hours and hours to find that kind of stuff. That is amazing stuff to find that.
That's awesome. So you're in Ohio there, right? Ohio, you said?
No, that was in Iowa. That was Iowa.
You're in Iowa. So we're moving around the nation, right? We're moving around the nation. Oh, yeah. There are pockets of Adventism. And I know somebody here said that, I think Lee Willard in our comments mentioned acknowledgement that there was slavery in the North, or there was pro-slavery sentiment in the North. And I want to affirm that and say absolutely amen. Now, Kevin is moving into Iowa, but it deep in the North, the reason I find Ellen White's dissent against the U.S. government during this period so compelling is because she does not fixate, or she does not direct her rebukes to the South exclusively. And in fact, I find that some of her harshest statements are toward the North and the complicity of the North. And I want to read a few things here. I want to just get into the text. I'm reading for our viewers from the Review and Herald, August 27, 1861. There's an article there called Communication from Sister White. That's a pretty stern title for the article. And in this article, Ellen White just goes off on the United States of America, not the South, just the whole thing, the Union, right? And she says this, quote, now listen to the language here. God will restrain his anger, but a little longer. His anger burns against this nation. And just let that sink in. I mean, just read that and then think of, you know, American evangelical patriotism, right? God bless America. America as a gift to this world. And just read these kind of statements to just qualify our patriotism. His anger burns against this nation, and especially against the religious bodies who have sanctioned and have themselves engaged in this terrible merchandise. Such injustice, such oppression, such sufferings, many professed followers of the meek and lowly Jesus can witness with heartless indifference. And many of them can inflict with hateful satisfaction this indescribable agony and yet dare to worship God. And then she says, it is a solemn mockery. And she goes on to talk about the North. Now, I've been reading a book by Mark Knoll. Maybe some of you have read this book by Mark Knoll. It's called America's God, published in 2002. And in the book, he talks about the theological arguments that were taking place at the time and even in the North about slavery and about, you know, during the Civil War and before the Civil War. And he argues that the dilemma was this dichotomy that said either support slavery and therefore remain biblical, or you're anti-slavery and you violate the Bible, because they kept pointing to the Old Testament, claiming that the Bible supports slavery. And Mark Knoll makes this powerful statement. He says that it had virtually no influence. This mentality that the Bible supports slavery had virtually no influence outside the United States. And that even among those who shared the conservative theology of slavery's defenders would not take the biblical mentions of slavery and jump to support the American form of slavery. So with that in context, I've been reading about what the pioneers were saying about the North. And here's another statement, and I'll just share this one more and then I'll shut up. This is again that original Ellen White statement that I made. I wanted to emphasize to our viewers that the pioneers were not just bashing on the South, they were also bashing on the North. And I quote, "God's scourge is now upon the North." This is Ellen White. "Because they have so long submitted to the advances of the slave power. The sin of Northern pro-slavery men is great." Notice, she's acknowledging that there are pro-slavery men in the North. "They have strengthened the South in their sin by sanctioning the extension of slavery. They have acted a prominent part in the bringing of the nation into its present distressed condition." So there's a very broad perspective here in the early pioneers. Even just their political acumen, they were aware of what was happening. They were aware of the debates in Congress. They were aware of the senators, even in the North, that were supporting slavery. And they applied their apocalyptic framework to criticize even those in the North.
I don't want to interrupt the preacher when he's preaching.
I can't see you, Ben. Where'd you go?
I see him.
See me?
Oh, you see him? Okay, as long as they can see him. Bring it, Ben. Bring it.
Yeah, I don't want to interrupt the preacher. I don't want to do that, but I do
want to interrupt me now. I'll keep going.
But I do want to share another quote that maybe the narrative of the battle can illustrate what Ellen White said about the culpability of the North in slavery. And it's from the same source that you just quoted. She said, "I had a view of the late disastrous battle at Manassas, Virginia. It was the most exciting, thrilling, distressing scene. The Southern Army had everything in their favor and were prepared for a dreadful contest. The Northern Army was moving on with triumph, not doubting but that they would be victorious. Many were reckless and marched forward boastingly, as though victory were already theirs. As they neared the battlefield, many were almost fainting through weariness and want of refreshment. They did not expect so fierce an encounter. They rushed in the battle and fought bravely, desperately. The dead and dying were on every side. Both the North and the South suffered severely. The Southern men felt the battle, and in a little, would have been driven back still further. Northern men were rushing on, although their destruction was very great. Just then, an angel descended and waved his hand backward. Instantly, there was confusion in their ranks. It appeared to the Northern men that their armies were retreating, when it was not in reality so. And a precipitate retreat commenced. It seemed wonderful to me. Then it was explained that God had this nation in his own hand and would suffer no victories to be gained faster than he ordained, and no more losses to the Northern men than in his wisdom he saw fit, to punish the North for their sin. And in this battle, had the Northern Army pushed the battle still further, in their fainting, exhausted condition, a far greater struggle and destruction awaited them, which would have caused great triumph in the South. God would not permit this and sent an angel to interfere. The sudden falling back of the Northern troops was a mystery to all. They knew not that God's hand was in the matter."
Break down the significance of that, Ben.
Well, from this pericope and others, it's clear that during the Civil War, God almost had a scale, and he was almost weighing out. Interestingly, this is the God of the investigative judgment. He was weighing out exactly what punishment to meet on the nation. She says sometimes he diminished the casualties. He made sure that there weren't as many casualties as there could have been. Other times he protracted the battle so that there would be more casualties. This was all in his perfect will to recompense the great sin of slavery against blacks. So she says that he was using the Civil War to wreak his perfect will, his perfect judgment on the nation. And so in Ellen White's conception, we see a couple of phases of God's judgment against the nation. There is the judgment during the Civil War, but there's also, she says, a judgment, a part of the final judgment, in which she said, the Jubilee commenced, and I saw the righteous slave rise up, and he goes to heaven. And she said, his slave master, meanwhile, is judged by God and condemned to hell. So we have the same plantation. One has one fate, the other a totally different fate. Wow. And so this is one thing that we have to realize when we're looking at the U.S. and race, that God will perfectly avenge all of the racial wrongs. You know, I was reading about a Millerite preacher, and this is in 1843. And so he believed that Jesus was going to come very soon. In fact, I believe that he believed in the first date, April. Kevin, is that right?
April. Yeah, that was.
Yeah, the first date. And he was on a train, and it was perfectly within his right to sit in the car that he was sitting in. In fact, he had double checked with the train agent. And he said, now, are you sure that I can sit in this seat? Because I don't want any friction. I don't want any drama. And the train agent said, yes, it's fine. Go ahead.
You're talking about a black Millerite, right, Ben?
Yes, a black Millerite, Millerite. The train left the station, and unbeknownst to him, a different train agent had come aboard. And he said, you cannot sit here as a black man. You have to move, okay? And so the black Millerite preacher showed him his train ticket, and the white agent said, I don't care. You have to go to the car. You have to go to a different car. It was several cars back. And so the Millerite preacher said, no, I bought this ticket. I checked with the agent. It's my right to sit here. And the next thing he knew, there were four or five of the train employees who severely beat him. And afterward, he would go to the hospital and he would need to have stitches. He had a concussion, etc. So they severely beat him. Now, as a black Millerite, he believed that Jesus was going to come within a matter of weeks, very shortly. He did what he could to get recompense for his beating, for his injustice, through the law. But as we know with blacks in the 1840s, that wasn't a channel that they could pursue successfully. And so he said, my only recourse is in the judgment of God. I can't get recourse through the law. I couldn't fight them because there were five of them. There were four or five of them beating me. So he said, my only recourse is the second advent. And so this was a spiritual and psychological salve for Black people when they couldn't get justice vis-a-vis the U.S. justice system. And so the pioneers, including Ellen White, talk about how whenever these Blacks were feeling that the racial justice was just, you know, unanswered, and you know, whites could just walk all over them, that the judgment of God was coming, and that God would recompense them for all of the racial injustices that they faced. However, all of this did not stop the Adventist pioneers from still speaking. You know, Jeffrey, I'm always awed that the pioneers believed that the second coming, they seem to believe this, and there's strong evidence of this in the documents, in their articles, that the Civil War was going to lead to the second coming. Even in Ellen White's writings in Testimonies Volume 1, she's discussing the back and forth of the Union Army and the Confederate Army, and she says there's perilous times coming, great distress, and it seems as if she is averring that the Civil War would close in the apocalypse, in the second coming. And it's interesting because Jesus says in Matthew 24 that nation shall rise against nation, ethnicity shall rise against ethnicity. All right, so there would be racial strife in the last days. But then interestingly, it says, and this gospel of the kingdom shall be preached in all the world for a witness unto all nations. So while there is ethnicity against ethnicity, the people of God preach the gospel to all ethnos. So while the ethnic strife is occurring all around them, they transcend that to preach to all ethnicities. Let me posit right here that Jesus has not come because we have not transcended ethnic strife. As a people, we have not transcended it to be able to preach it, as we always say, a character witness, martyria, right? The character witness. That's Matthew 24, 14. Revelation 14, 6. And this gospel of the kingdom shall be preached in all the world. Help me out. Revelation 14, 6. And I saw another angel.
Angel preaching the everlasting gospel.
Having the everlasting gospel preached on the earth to every ethnos, kindred, tongue, and people. And so for a faithful and powerful rendering of the three angels' messages, we have to be able to preach them to all the world without regard to ethnicity and without prejudice. So this is a very interesting dynamic, how the pioneers almost thought that these racial matters would lead to Jesus' second coming, but yet they are speaking out on them just as vociferously with what they thought the parousia right at hand. I think that when we think the second coming is at hand, that we want to get on our knees and pray, which is nothing wrong with that. You know, we want to search our hearts. Meanwhile, when they thought the parousia was at hand, they were rebuking racial sin, as well as preaching the gospel, but they were rebuking the sin of racism. So it goes hand in hand.
That's very potent. That's very potent. And it makes me think, you know, when you were reading Ellen White there, it made me think, she sounds so Amos, you know, so minor prophets, just on top of a hill, just preaching against, because she's addressing nation, right? She's not just addressing an individual. She's saying God has a controversy against this nation, right? In the one I read, God's anger waxes hot against this nation. And it really made me think of the prophets of old who were warning kings and rulers that they were not exempt from the judgments of God, and that God takes into account when structures of power crush the weak and the vulnerable, that God doesn't turn his head. And so inspiring what you've read there. And also, we're gonna have to land the plane there. I don't know what else to do there. I don't know how you cannot land the plane there in our conversation, but I wanted to just underscore, Ben, when you were saying there that the pioneers sensed that the issue of ethnic strife or racial strife was so significant that it would usher in the end. That's the magnitude that they saw in it. And I know, and even hinted at some of the comments here, I know that that sounds a bit like, what? It sounds a bit, what do you mean? It's about race? And I just wanted to highlight that when we think about it, it's not about race. It's about what we've been saying over and over again for these last two conversations. It's about the gospel's emphasis on human dignity. And that translates to a dissent against the abuse of human rights, the abuse of human dignity. And the gospel compels Christians to redress the wrongs in society, because God himself, it's in the very heart of God, not to separate these things from the gospel. So I think that's so powerful when you said that. Yes.
Can I read one more brief quote that I think links it together?
Yes.
This is Sister White again. She says, "I was shown that perplexity and fear have seized all hearts. God is punishing this nation for their sins. The sin of slavery has long existed. It has been a curse to this nation. It has been a curse to this nation." Kevin, didn't you say that the curse of Ham was the American slaveholders?
Yeah. That's how they're talking about it.
Okay. All right. It has been a curse to this nation. The cries and groans and agony of God's creatures held in bondage, placed upon a level with brute creatures by their fellow men, have risen to heaven. Now, this is sanctuary talk.
Mm.
Stuff and smells and aromas and smoke reaching up to heaven. This is sanctuary talk. What does racism have to do with the investigative judgment?
Come on now.
I need to give this to Jeffrey or David or Ty so that they can preach it.
That's okay? Wow.
All right. The fugitive slave law that went forth was calculated to crush out of man every noble, generous feeling of sympathy that should arise in his heart for the oppressed and suffering slave. It was in direct opposition to the teachings of Christ. This is going somewhere. Watch this. God's scourge, Lee is listening, is now upon the North, that they have so long submitted to suffer slavery to exist and their fellow man to be held in hopeless slavery. Let me ask you a question. Does God have a scourge on those who simply allow racism? Even if they don't directly participate in it, does he have a scourge on those who simply allow it? Maybe if they're silent?
The scope includes complicity, passive complicity.
Yes, God's scourge is now upon the North, that they have so long submitted to suffer slavery to exist and their fellow man to be held in hopeless slavery, tyrannized over and tortured just as passionate man chooses to act out the demon. If they murder their fellow man, no matter, he is considered no more than a brute by them. Now, this is the clincher, and this is when Ellen White joins slavery, racism, America, and the second coming. Listen to her language. I saw that the inhabitants of earth have nearly filled their cup of iniquity. We know all of that language, that Revelation 14, that Revelation 18 language. Some passages in Ezekiel and Isaiah, their cup is now full. So she says that through racism, through slavery, the inhabitants of the earth have nearly filled their cup of iniquity. This is not just politics. This has to do with the investigative judgment. This has to do with the second coming. This has to do with our doctrines. This has to do with preaching the gospel. This is not politics. Get that out of your mind. If you are allowing racism, allowing discrimination, just permitting it to happen on your watch, Ellen White says that God's scourge is upon you, and through this great sin of racism, that the inhabitants of earth have nearly filled their cup of iniquity.
She gets serious with that too, right? Because she adds, Ben and everyone else, she adds that whenever there is a pro-slavery Adventist that comes out of the woodwork as the Civil War erupts, right? Alexander Ross, the only pro-slavery Adventist that we know of by name. There were very few of them.
He done made a mistake.
He comes out of the woodwork, right? And she says to him, we cannot fellowship with you, and the church must withdraw its fellowship with you. She basically says, pro-slavery Adventist, he doesn't own slaves. He lives in New York. He doesn't own slaves. He's just racist. She says, he must be disfellowshipped. And it's not just for him. It's not just for him. She also wants to make sure that the Adventist Church's reputation is protected. If you look at that quote, she stresses that we must not allow anyone else to think that we are complicit in the sin of slavery.
Kevin, Ben, this is all huge, huge stuff. we have to land the plane here, but wow, we can only Kevin. we were to line up the list of legitimate grounds for disfellowship. Man, we have lost the plot when we focus on. we would disfellowship somebody for some lifestyle issue, for some consumption of some beverage, for some other addiction. But man, when there's blatant racism in the church, that's grounds for disfellowship. That's ground. Call the elders together, and let's sort this thing out. I think throughout the course of this conversation, it's become unmistakably clear that the early Adventists conceived of the everlasting gospel and of the three angels' messages as so in tune with human dignity that, going back to you, Kevin, for an Adventist preacher to head south, he's dangerous, because when he starts preaching, when we preach about the Sabbath, when we preach about the second coming, when we preach about the millennium, when we preach the sanctuary message, the spirit and the heart in which we preach those messages should be so intertwined with human dignity that it should threaten systems of abuse. The early church pioneers understood that the call to preach, we're landing the plane now, that the call to preach the gospel did not lead them to neglect addressing the social ills of society, that they did not compartmentalize social political issues over here and religious issues over here. That was basically heresy. That mentality is heretical because it divorces the gospel from real humanity. It collapses the gospel to mere theoretical doctrine and theology, and it does not fuse theology into the human experience. So they did not compartmentalize social and political issues on the one hand and religious issues over here. Like Doug said, they didn't have a box where they can throw controversial issues in society in the politics box and think that they can get away in the judgment of God, because newsflash, God looks into the politics box as well. God has access to that box. Yeah. And so when the principle of human dignity was involved, there was no distinction between what the gospel was and what social issues were. And we land there. We didn't even get to Reconstruction. I thought for sure we would get to Reconstruction. But alas, we failed once again.
Well, we've got more coming.
I want to thank you all. I want to thank Doug, Ben, Kevin for this conversation. And I want to thank our viewers for joining us. Next week, we're going to get into Reconstruction. We're going to get past, hopefully we pop our heads up on the other end of the Civil War. Hopefully we can get on the other end of the Civil War. And we're going to talk about Reconstruction. We're going to talk about Adventism during that period after the Civil War, after the abolition of slavery. And we're going to analyze, was slavery truly abolished? Was racism truly abolished? Obviously not. We're going to look at how Adventists continued the refrain of their take on what the everlasting gospel means and what the implications are for society through the 1870s and beyond. Is that Ben?
Sorry. Can we also answer any questions that the audience may have?
My friend, that is a a dangerous mistake.
Any single question a race from amalgamation to regional conferences to KKK flags on Adventist campuses, any question they have on race, can we answer those?
Yeah, so what we'll do is we will set up for the next meeting. Set up a Q&A. We will set up a way for viewers to pre-submit questions. And when you pre-submit those questions, they'll show up here and we'll have a dedicated moment where we'll take some minutes. We'll address questions for next session. So keep that in mind. You'll receive instructions on how to do that. I'm sure Brandon is listening to me somewhere in the internet galaxy, and he'll make that work. Thank you all again. Yep, we'll get into all those topics in the future. Thank you for joining us, and we will see you next week, same time, same place.